You know, I don't care what year it is. It's still amazing when the Pittsburgh Penguins come to town.
I know, it's not every day you get to watch the best player in the world.
That's true. Crosby was there too.
Let's go!
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a little ridiculous.
Good boy.
Play all the hits!
Left Toronto Maple Leafs. Let me finish.
How am I supposed to go to bed after watching that?
I'm quite hyped.
With you wherever you are, welcome to LFR.
Oh, you've had such a good run!
It's okay, you're out of practice. I don't like the Western road trip either. Let's put our heads together for Austin Matthews' teeth.
Leafs win! 4-1 over the Pittsburgh Penguins. That, my friends, is a win they can build on. Hyped aspect about this game, the fans are back! Well, I mean, fans have been back for a while. 500 of them, which, who came up with 500? 500 and they're not even sitting far apart? Anyway, it kind of feels like we've had that conversation enough. But at very least, Scotiabank Arena is back to half capacity. Martina Ortiz-Luis singing the national anthem. Like, there! Actually there. The viewing experience is just better. It's like how Nonna makes all her food with love. And while love isn't an actual ingredient, yes it absolutely is! It's better! Now, low-key thing about this game, though, there's actually kind of some drama. Nick Ritchie is on the Toronto Marlies, and he scored on the power play. That's pretty cool. And according to a tweet from Kevin McGran, who got to talk to Nick Ritchie, he's not very happy. And you can say all the stuff that everyone always says in these situations. I wish someone would pay me $1.7 million to play in the American Hockey League. But at the end of the day, people have pride. Adam Brooks claimed off waivers. Adam Brooks immediately put back on waivers. We can maybe talk about that a little bit later. But in order to make space, the Leafs sent Timothy Liljegren down to the minors, and it wasn't a paper transaction. Like, he actually went. As in, he can't be on the Leafs right now. And for some reason, Sheldon Keefe decided to go with Riley Brody, normal, Muzzin Sandin, pardon, and Dermot Hall. I haven't been a fan of the dermatologist pairing for a while now, but Sandin on the right? On the shutdown pair? That's a lot of distractions heading into a game against a team that has kind of run your show this year in the Pittsburgh Penguins. You've played them twice and the game where they shut you out was the best one, you know? So you're gonna want to start hot. And within the first 30 seconds, they do! Best player in the entire world. Lines up for a face-off with Sidney Crosby. It's one back into the leave zone. It's not even like the Penguins make that egregious of an error here. Brian Rust just sort of makes a calculation in the offensive zone that goes wrong. The Penguins have a defender up, but it's okay because Sidney Crosby is back. Problem being, Sidney Crosby is guarding Matthews. TJ Brody hits Matthews with a pass. Breakaway snipe! Austin Matthews with his 33rd of the season makes it 1-0, and I need to see this number. This is probably a weird instinct, and I promise it wasn't pessimism. When Matthews got that breakaway, I didn't think it was gonna go in. And the reason for that being, Matthews doesn't score a ton of breakaway goals. Why? Because he's bad? No, because who gives Austin Matthews a breakaway? He's a dominant player, yes, but that goal would be strange for any team to give up because they always send their best and brightest after him. And it was especially surprising in the Penguins, who have done so well against the Leafs, and just like that, seconds into the game, the Leafs are up 1-0. Not long after, Jack Campbell leaves the net, Jack Campbell gets knocked down, and if you're a goaltender— Oh, he stopped it. Producer Drew and I were talking all night, and we're pretty sure we're gonna put that in hat picks, but we're not sure. Jack Campbell with a dang it that turned into a hat pick from a big save. I don't know, what do you think? Campbell, who has a great relationship, great respect from all Leafs fans, he gets to hear the soup chants again. And after that squirrely moment, he seemed to settle in. And there was actually an excellent pace to the first period. Leafs outshot the Pittsburgh Penguins 15-12 when it was all said and done. I'm not sure I saw the chances that way, but it was tight. It was close. The Leafs had some really good chances and Jari had to be really sharp, but Campbell was that much better. There's a save he made on Gensel. Oh, 5 minutes into the second, Leafs legend Evan Rodriguez holds Andre Kasha. You can't do that, so he goes to the box.
Double agent.
On the power play, Leafs have the puck behind their own net. Morgan Rielly breaks it out, and Morgan Rielly is looking for someone, and Morgan Rielly is gonna find someone at the blue line. Maybe he's gonna do the drop pass. Oh my god, he's going for it! Oh my god, what a goal! Okay, that one's going in hat picks. Morgan Rielly? Why? Tessa had to have been in the building, wasn't she? Morgan Rielly, I felt bad for the Penguins. They've won 3 cups since the Leafs last won a playoff round. Sidney Crosby was drafted a year after the Leafs last won a playoff round, and I feel bad for them.
Steve, you didn't need to say all that. You're right. Yeah, that's fair. But I did. I thought about it, and now you have to as well. We suffer together. We're like a family.
Now, we all know how this ends because the Leafs end up winning the game. You probably saw in the title, and you might have heard me when I screamed Leafs win off the top.
And it's kind of peculiar that they won, because typically teams that take 4 consecutive penalties don't win! Dermott takes a penalty, and that's a shame, because when he's in the lineup, he's often on the penalty kill. But the Leafs kill it off. Almost as soon as they kill it off, Mitch Marner takes a penalty, which is a huge problem, because he's maybe the Leafs' best penalty killer. At the end of the second period, Alexander Kerfoot takes a penalty. He's part of the penalty kill. Can we stop? But somehow, that did not stop the Leafs from getting a shorty. David Kampf just clamping down on Chris Letang. He gives it to Morgan Rielly, and oh my goodness, he's gonna do it again! Letang gets back just enough. He's diving. Rielly hooks it around him. Kampf receives it. Kampf with the move, and not even Jari knocking the net off could stop Kampf from scoring an underratedly hilarious part about it. While he was celebrating the goal, he skates right by Chris Letang and has to lift a leg over him. David Kampf now has shorthanded goals in back-to-back games. He has 7 goals on the season. His career high is 8, and last year, he had 1! This dude had 17 goals in 235 games with the Blackhawks. He's got 7 in 47. His career high is 19 points. He's got 16. I didn't know who he was when the Leafs signed him! That's why, by the way, a lot of Leaf fans are concerned. I'm not gonna lie, I'm a little concerned because there's a guy named Brandon Hagel who's apparently available at the trade deadline. Now, some of you are like, yes, yes, I understand the Brandon Hagel. And others are like, I don't know who that person is. Did you make him up? And the answer is no. And the Chicago Blackhawks want like a first and a prospect for him. Now, I am not endorsing the Leafs going out and trading for a 23-year-old player who makes only $1.5 million against the cap for the next 2 seasons after this one. And he's scoring at about a 50-point pace. Oh my goodness, I'm talking myself into it. No, no, I'm not talking myself into it. I'm not, but if there was a team who the Leafs can be trusted to understand, I think it might be the Blackhawks. Best kept secret, apparently, and it's 3-0 after 2. Morgan Rielly and David Kampf, by the way, key in those penalty kills during the second period and on the 3-0 goal. Now, the third period was strange to me. To me, all these things are true. The third period was the only period where the Pittsburgh Penguins scored. That's indisputable. The third period was the periods where the Penguins outshot the Leafs by the most, 19-8. And number 3, for me personally, it was the Penguins' least dangerous period. Yes, there was the Penguins' 1 goal. It was a series of errors that begins with a Rasmus Sandin pinch. He does that on the right side. Jake Muzzin comes back on the right side to make up for it while Marner is playing left D, and it's just no, it's not good news. Jeff Carter does the work. Malkin finishes it. But just as I'm starting to get the Hamina tweets from people who are scarred, frankly, Marner, big shot block. He doesn't look comfortable at all. Gets the puck to Matthews, streaking up the right wing. Sick backhand saucer pass to Michael Bunting. Like Kampf, receives it, makes the move on Jari, scores. Tristan Jari allowed 4 goals in this game, and you can't blame a single one of them on him. One thing I've talked about with the Leafs is, to me, from last year, they look totally different offensively. They're a dirtier, nastier team in front of the net, and they're willing to just eat garbage all day, just banging goals. This game featured 4 Mona Lisas. Bunting's 16th, by the way. Now, before we talk about the thing that I was asked about a lot, I want to talk a little bit more about the third. Penguins outshot the Leafs 15-6 in the second period. That's bad. It's also not surprising on account of, well, the Penguins were losing for the entirety of the second period, and also, they had 3 consecutive power plays. That's just in the second as well. If you go into the third, they had 4. Rielly, too, another penalty killer, and the Leafs managed to kill that off. Their penalty kill was amazing tonight. But to me, the big chances that Campbell had to stop for the most part, first period, he had to make some big saves and some tone-setting saves. Second period, really did a good job holding them in and helping everyone feel confident. I almost said the players, but really, it was me. Robbing Brian Rust, getting across. Kasperi Kapanen with the move, stopping him too. But generally, in the third period, I saw a lot of shots from range that Campbell just sort of easily gloved down, which we actually saw a lot of in Seattle as well. If there's a turning of the tide going on for the Leafs defense, that would be wonderful. There might have been a fleeting moment where, after Malkin scored, it felt like the Penguins could hypothetically get back in this game. But after Bunting made it 4-1, no, not a chance. You can definitely look at the tail of the tape for this game and say the Leafs got outshot 46-29. The Penguins just got goalied. And while Jack was great and made some great saves, It's just not how I see this game. Drury was great too. I don't think the chances were that different, at least in the first two periods. A lot of the shots in the third period were the Penguins trying to generate something and the Leafs not letting them. Last and perhaps most unfortunate, Austin Matthews going into the offensive zone, as he does, going behind the other team's net, as he does. Smashing his face into the crossbar, as no one wants to ever! Dude, I was worried about this one. This did not look comfortable at all. The more I watched the replay, the more gruesome it was. I think it was the Hockey Collective on Instagram highlighted one of Matthews' teeth flying out of his mouth. He seems to come down like right on the corner of the outside corner of the crossbar, and there's just not a lot of give in that net. And your face is made of face, and it looked really painful. Now you never know what's going on in the moment, obviously, unless you're, you know, a doctor. My mind was racing. I got more than one text saying, could that be a broken jaw? And broken jaws are bad news. I interviewed Nazem Kadri when he was with the Canadian World Junior team, and he was coming off a jaw injury from junior where his doctor told him it would take upwards of 2 years to heal fully. Like, he could play, but it would take 2 years for it to... It's bad! You don't want to think about concussion. You do not want to think about it. Luckily, as far as we know so far, it ended up being what it looked like. He lost a tooth. You ever short circuit? Anyway, he returned to the game and he was fine. Jack Campbell won. The Leafs won. Fans are back. Hooray. Questions. If scoring a goal from end to end isn't an Olympic sport, it should be. You just reminded me that Morgan Riley was probably going to make the Canadian Olympic team and now I'm sad. Was this not a great game? It was. It was. I think tight games where the score is tight are the most fun to watch. Sometimes it's not as fun watching your team be dominant. I thought the Leafs were a dominant team. At times. I think you can dominate at times, and it can have an effect on the game, if that makes sense. If you look at the overall picture of the game, if you look at the shots, no. No team that dominated all night long takes four consecutive penalties. But the penalty kill was very good. Campbell was very good. The defense did a pretty good job at limiting scoring opportunities. And holy cow, once again, those four goals they scored were incredible. Who's not getting out of their seat for those? Like, I celebrate every goal the Leafs score, and when they bang it in, it's wonderful. Each one of the four goals they scored tonight caused me to scream at my television. Are you going to the Heritage Classic in the Hammer? I'll be there. Yes, Andrew, I am. I do plan on going to the is it the Winter Classic or the Heritage Classic? Heritage Classic in Hamilton, Ontario, where they're going to have a new team. No, we're not having that conversation again. Well, in a while we will. Anyway, yeah, I'm pretty sure I'm going to go to the outdoor game against the Buffalo Sabres. Just not confirmed yet. And last but not least, I wanted to shout out Jason, who convinced me to call this episode Teeth, and the E's are 33 because Matthew scored his 33 of the season and he hurt his teeth. And also, they came out with a new Aretinas jersey with a T in the middle. That's why. Also, Drew, can you do editing magic? Here it is! There's the jersey. That's the jersey for the outdoor game. A lot of you are unsure about it. And I understand. It is very plain. For some reason, I love it. I love it. I love it. The dark blue. I love it. You can't explain. Okay? That's the thing about love. Like, why do you justify it? Why do you like something, people will say. And then you try to come up with every answer in the world when the only correct one is, because I do! I love them. And I love you. I can love both. For now, that is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell all your friends. Brand new Steve Dangle podcast coming tomorrow. Game over Montreal. Game over international. Shout out Canada's women's team for winning gold! Again, you can go back and watch the breakdown of all of that. Noxie and Cax. The Chris Johnston Show. Spicy. A lot of trade deadline content in there. And the Leafs mentioned some things good, some things, well, we'll see. And also, Agent Provocateur. Two-part series this week, so you want to be an NHL agent, where Alan Walsh talks about how you become an NHL agent, as well as some news and notes. Fascinating stories, two-parter, it's so good. SDPN, why aren't you subscribed yet? Oh, you are. Oh, that's good. But the rest of you, figure it out.